Mengele prepared to flee Europe, leaving Irena and their son Rolf behind. Hans Sedlmayr, the Mengele family lawyer, made the necessary arrangements, paying an underground SS network to help Mengele escape. Innsbruck in Austria was the last stop before the Brenner Pass leading to Italy. Once over the border, Josef Mengele would be protected by Roman Catholic priests. It was Easter Sunday. Mengele reached the Italian port of Genoa, the final leg of his flight from Europe. Presenting himself as Helmut Gregor, a displaced prisoner of war, he applied for an international Red Cross passport at the Swiss consulate. His request was granted. In July 1949, the North King set sail for Argentina with Mengele aboard, 4.5 years after the liberation of Auschwitz. After more than a month at sea, Mengele, alias Helmut Gregor, arrived in Buenos Aires. At the dock, his contact never appeared. With nowhere to stay, he took a taxi into town and registered at a third-class hotel, the Palermo. The Buenos Aires that Mengele discovered was the refuge of choice for Nazi fugitives. It had a large and influential German community into which he could easily disappear. Nazis were welcomed in Argentina by dictator Juan Perón. His sympathy was based not only on ideology. Perón was suspected of having benefited from treasures smuggled into Argentina by the Nazis. Crates of gold and valuables from the death camps turned into currency and deposited into the bank accounts of Perón's wife, Evita. Mengele moved to Calle Arenales, a neighborhood popular with German expatriates. His first contact was a former member of the SS, Willem Sassen.
Esta relación fue muy buena.
Mengele told Sassen about his experiences at Auschwitz, describing in detail his medical experiments.
Pero su tarea de verdad era...
He wanted to find out to what extreme can you expose a human being mentally, physically, etc., etc. It all had a philosophical significance, I can assure you that.
Sassen was honored to introduce Mengele into his circle of German friends, among them former SS officer Adolf Eichmann, also hiding in Buenos Aires. Mengele relaxed amongst his Nazi comrades. He joined the Kameradenwerk, a powerful underground Nazi network with influential ties to business and government. Mengele met its reputable leader, Hans Udo.
Hush money was paid directly. They had excellent ties with the authorities, and this money came in quantities from Germany through German companies that were represented in South American countries.
These documents reveal how Argentine police tracked Mengele's every move. Yet the information was only used to extort money in return for silence. Hans Rudel became Mengele's guardian in Argentina and his entree into German high society. Far from a fugitive existence, Mengele enjoyed the good life. A patron of fine dining and the arts, the Cologne Theatre was a particular favorite. Here he was surrounded by the Nazi elite who, like himself, had evaded justice. Seven years after Mengele arrived in Argentina, in Germany, his estranged wife Irena grew weary of their marriage. Trying to keep their bond alive, Mengele sent letters and poems to his son. This is a children's book he illustrated for Rolf. In 1955, a letter arrived from his wife in Germany. Irena wanted a divorce. Mengele went to the West German embassy in Buenos Aires to sign over a power of attorney. The document bore his real name. The ink on his divorce papers was barely dry when a new woman entered his life. Her name was Marta, the widow of Mengele's younger brother. Their wedding had been arranged by his father, Karl. Marta held shares in the Mengele firm, and Karl was intent on keeping all shares within the family. In 1956, traveling undercover as Helmut Gregor, Mengele flew to Switzerland to meet his new bride. Family lawyer Hans Sedlmeier made all the necessary arrangements. From Switzerland, Mengele drove to Germany. It was 11 years after Auschwitz, yet in Germany there was still no warrant for his arrest. Back in Argentina, the SS doctor was joined by his new wife, Marta, and her son, Karl Heinz. They lived openly as the Mengele family, listed in the telephone directory. That same year, Mengele paid yet another visit to the German embassy. By now, the diplomatic staff was well acquainted with him.
Mengele secured from the German embassy in Argentina a passport under his own name. He was notorious. They know all about him. And the fact that he was able to do that, and he was never apprehended and brought to trial.
During the 1950s, only a few individuals were struggling to bring former war criminals to justice. One of them, Hermann Langbein, was a former political prisoner of Auschwitz.
We were forced to realize that nothing was done, and we filed suit against the political department of Auschwitz and then against Mengele.
Langbein uncovered Mengele's divorce papers with his Argentinian address. He convinced a German state prosecutor to issue an arrest warrant to be followed by an extradition order. By 1959, the information had reached Israel. Its secret intelligence agency, Mossad, headed by Issa Harel, had been preparing an operation designed to send shockwaves through the Nazi community in South America. On the 11th of May, 1960, Israeli Mossad agents kidnapped the SS officer Adolf Eichmann. Hiding him in their safe house in Buenos Aires, Eichmann was interrogated for hours about Josef Mengele. But Eichmann remained loyal to his comrade and refused to cooperate.
At one stage, Eichmann told me, I'm not prepared to give away a comrade. Even if I know where he is, if I know his name, I'd rather die. He told me that at one stage. I'm not prepared to betray a comrade.
The Mossad agents soon discovered that Mengele no longer lived in Argentina. Tipped off about a German request for his extradition, Mengele fled Argentina, leaving behind Marta and her son, who returned to Germany. Mengele went to Paraguay, a country with no extradition treaty with Germany. Paraguay was the latest haven for Nazis on the run. Its ruler, Alfredo Stroessner, was a dictator of German descent. Hans Rudel's organization, the Kameradenwerk, found him shelter and helped get Paraguayan citizenship. A steady flow of cash was sent by Hans Sedlmayr from Germany, and Mengele finally felt secure. Until he read about the capture of Eichmann. With Mossad on his trail, Mengele was once again on the run. He slipped across the border into Brazil and made contact with Wolfgang Gerhard, another member of the Kameradenwerk. At Mossad headquarters in Israel, Mengele was placed at the top of their hit list. Mossad set up a special unit of agents to comb South America for clues as to the whereabouts of the Angel of Death.
No stone was left untouched. I remember I traveled in Montevideo, in Uruguay, in Paraguay, in Bolivia. I met people, of course, undercover, and a German. I was a German correspondent writing a book about SS. Of course, I was looking for Mengele. To interview him.
6 weeks later, agents in the field got a break. The man who was once Mengele's best friend was located and recruited by Mossad. Willem Sassen was a willing stool pigeon and betrayed his Nazi comrade for $5,000 cash. Sassen gave the name and Brazilian residence of Mengele's protector, Wolfgang Gerhard.
And we worked on Gerhard, we followed him. We found out where is his, not only his home in Sao Paulo, but he had a farm outside Sao Paulo. And we followed him in all kind of disguises.
But Mengele managed to stay one step ahead of the Israelis. Gerhard moved him to Nova Europa, a remote German colony some 200 miles from Sao Paulo. There he met Geza and Gita Stammer, a Hungarian couple who employed him to manage their farm. Mengele surrounded his latest sanctuary with dogs and barbed wire. Suspicious of everyone, he was withdrawn, unsociable, and disliked having his picture taken. These are the only photos of him during this period.
He was not very easy. He was a person who, when somebody contradicted him, became immediately impatient. He was very temperamental.
In 1963, after 10 months in the field, Mossad agents were unable to locate Mengele. They were recalled. Operation Mengele was shelved along with any hope of justice. In Germany, despite recent publicity over a 1960s war crimes trial, no move was made to pursue Mengele. It would appear that maintaining normal diplomatic relations with South America was of greater German interest.
At the end of 1965, I was transferred to Paraguay, and before I left, received order from the Foreign Office not to do anything in the matter of Mengele.
In 1969, the Stammers moved to a new house in Caeira.